Yeah, I will talk about recent paper with Mete, Convex Duality with Transaction Cost. So we change the title a bit, so in the slides here there's other title. Okay, so let's start maybe with describing the setup. So we will work in a simple setup of with one risky asset, which is continuous, I mean work in continuous time. We assume that we have one risky asset, and the risky asset has continuous path. We will deal with super application. Okay, so in a minute I will introduce an option, but we assume that there is only one risky asset, and the bundle count is normalized to one. So it's a very simple setup. And we want to deal with super application, not we will deal with two types of super application. One, when we assume that there is a model, and the other, when we don't assume that there is a model. It's called model free edging or robust edging. And essentially, we will prove that this is under transaction cost, they have the same super application price, if the model is have enough fluctuation. What's mean enough fluctuation? So we will take the same conditions that in the paper of Gossoni and Bisogni and Schankmeier, we will introduce this concept, use this concept of conditional pool support. Yeah, so it says that a stock has, if we have a non-negative stock, we say that we have a conditional pool support if, as you can hear, but let's say less formally, it means the following. And mute. So it means, following, let's say, if you take continuous process, it means that, suppose we have a time, this is the time, and you have maturity, you take any time t, and here you take a function, any continuous function, then with any epsilon, with every epsilon, the process has a positive probability to be in a pipe. Yeah, you can consider this is the path, so we consider some epsilon pipe across the path, and the conditional probability, so take this is like an open set across the path, the conditional probability is that the stock will be in this set, conditioning on the previous information, and of course, one thing that you need that ST will start, yes, so you need that ST will start with the same point as the path start. So ST is, let's say, equal, this path is called X. So this is, this conditional probability is non-negative, non-negative for every epsilon. And of course, this conditional probability is a random variable, so this is almost sure. So it means that we have enough fluctuation. And most of the processes which are used in finance are satisfying this this assumption. In fact, processes which are not semi-martingales, as fractional Brownian motion, satisfy this assumption. Okay, so this kind of process even you don't need to impose any martingale properties. Just to it says that the model fluctuates enough. In fact, there is a paper by Gossoni from 2006, which if a process is Gaussian as a fractional Brownian motion, there is a nice condition on the kernel, so you can know if it has a condition of full support or not. I don't remember the condition, but it's a paper by Gossoni from 2006. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is that we won't assume any semi-martingale properties, just if we have enough fluctuation. Okay, so we will take the simple models. We have a transaction cost, and we have the same proportional transaction cost for buying and selling. Okay, we have a constant number kappa, and any buying or selling, we have a proportional transaction cost. We also assume that it's some kind of technical condition, it's very important, but we assume that we have a liquidation at maturity, yeah, that's why we have, so we should liquidate the portfolio. And here in the Stieltjes integral, we start with zero stock. So if you make a transfer at zero, you pay transaction cost. Okay? So in fact, this is the portfolio value and all the integrals here. Usually when you do transaction cost, you need the trading strategy will be a bound variation, otherwise you have infinite transaction cost. So what the formula is written here, you see that you don't, the integrals are defined pass by pass, as still as integral, because gamma has bound variation. So to define the portfolio strategy with the transaction cost, you don't need any semi-marking your property. If the stock is continuous, then for any bound variation portfolio strategy, the portfolio is well defined, and this is the formula for the portfolio. Yes, sorry. The K is the cap. Okay, so we want to deal with super application. So assume we have the path-dependent option. Okay, path-dependent options mean formally we have a map of the set of continuous functions to the real line. Okay. For our results, we will need quite strong assumption on F, but let's ignore this. So we have a path-dependent option, and super application price is defined in a simple setup as the minimal initial capital, such that you can super-replicate the claim almost surely, and we don't put any disability conditions. In fact, for most of the results, they are not necessary. Here we don't, the portfolio should not be bounded by some random variable. We just should super-replicate at maturity the random variable. Okay, so this is the classical, this is some kind of introduction to the classical problem with transaction. So what's a buy and hold strategy? Buy and hold strategy means that at zero you trade, or allocate your portfolio because you start with zero stocks, so you make some trade, and then you do nothing. So the theorem was started as a conjecture. So the conjecture was, suppose you have a Black-Scholes model, I think it's conjecture from 94. So suppose you have a Black-Scholes model, constant volatility or volatility 1. Yeah. And you want to super-replicate a call option with transaction cost. Now this is the K of the strike here. So, so conjecture was from 94, I think, by Davis and other guy, I don't remember now. Says that the best thing you can do is just to do buy and hold strategy. So there are several versions in the sense that if you pay liquidation cost at maturity or at zero, but eventually if kappa goes to zero, it doesn't matter. So if kappa goes to zero, the super application price of this option is as zero. Okay, you need to buy this. So and this conjecture was proved. First proof was by Zoner. They use kind of a stochastic control approach. Later there was some other, but also in their paper you need some admissibility condition, and there was some kind of evolution in this paper. But the most general result, at least, says the following. So the most general result says, and again you don't need admissibility condition. The most general result is from for one asset is 2008, and it's this paper that I told by Guassoni, Guassoni and Schachmeier. It says they did options not pass dependent, like options which depend on the stock at maturity, but their approach can be extended. So the theorem says that if you have an option of this form, and you don't need to impose Black-Scholes model, we just need the conditional full support of the stock, so it can be fractional going in motion or whatever. Then the limit of the super application prices when kappa goes to zero is equal to concave envelope of S0. But of course here concave envelope is X. But in fact, and we know that concave envelope is exactly the infimum over all lines that control the function from above, and lines here exactly by whole side. Okay, so this most general result in the sense that you don't need other papers assumed some kind of marginal structure, and also you don't need admissibility condition. So so that's what I'm writing on the slide, some kind of history of this problem. I put myself searching for game options. Good chance to put myself. but anyway, and it's kind of so just few examples, okay, just few examples. So again, the call option here, this formula is, again, I wrote for limit kappa goes to zero, but this is like if you're paying transaction cost at zero and at maturity, in fact, you get this kind of expression. Or for a put option, you get a strike price equal to K. And one example, if you take look back option, you cannot super replicate a look back option. Okay, it's not in this paper, but it can be shown by using this kind of arguments. And if I don't have time, I will explain why it's in this form. Okay, so super back option, you can also replicate with transaction. So this was the introduction, and now I will try to explain what we did. So we wanted to avoid the situation that you don't have any sense in dynamical hedging for super replication. And observe in all of these examples, legally, in all of these previous examples, you see that knowing the model doesn't give you anything. So in all these examples, you super replicate if you suppose don't know nothing about the stock, this is the super replication process. So in all of this example, one of the consequences that if you know the model or you don't know the model, it doesn't give you anything. Yeah? If the model is fluctuates enough. In all these examples, they are true if the stock have the conditional full support law. Okay? So if you know the model or don't know the model, you get the same answer. And you get the same answer, and you don't have any sense in dynamical hedging. So what we assume the following. So suppose we have some n options, which are available in the market. So we don't need to super replicate them. We have them ready in the market for a given price pi. So it means that we can have a static position of this form for this price. And we assume that we buy options. If you want to say that you can sell options, just put in the family, instead of F1, Fn, you can put minus F1, minus F2, minus F1. So there's no loss of generality if you say that the CI should be non-negative. There is no loss of generality. Just put in your set also the minus of the function. Okay. So that's what we assume, that you can you have n positions that you don't need to super replicate, but they are ready, and it's kind of a big assumption because we assume that we have a power option. Okay, so we have a function that, in the meantime, maybe later I will tell regularity condition, but what is the most important here is that we assume that we have a power option that we can buy for a fixed price. We don't need to super replicate. Okay. Super replicate power option, the transaction cost is not possible. So in that sense, this is the main reason why we will see that there is a sense of dynamical hedging, because we have the power option. So here I just write some kind of formal condition, but in fact you can just say that F is a power option with some power, or you think with power 2, it's not very important, it's just a formal condition. Okay, so you have n options, and at least one of them is a power. Now we deal with super replication with proportional transaction cost. So this is just kind of maybe a remark. So we have n options, and consider we have a kind of assumption which seems that it should be equivalent to no arbitrage assumptions, but we didn't prove it. We don't define arbitrage, we don't deal with arbitrage, but it seems that it should be some kind of related. So it says the following. So we take the canonical space of the function, and assume that there exists at least one Martingale measure such that the prices under this measure are less than the PI. Okay, and this assumption is some kind of makes sense, because if you deal with transaction cost on the stock, you also want to say that there are transaction costs on the static positions. In this, exactly this assumption. So transaction costs on the static positions means that there is some Martingale measure, that expectation is less than the price in the market. So the difference, in some sense, the difference can be considered as a transaction cost also on the positions. But we need this assumption for the proof point of view. And I mean, formally, one question that we didn't deal with, we did, but you can ask whether, if you don't have this assumption, can you get asymptotic arbitrage as kappa goes to zero or not? I mean, I don't know. But technically, this is assumption, which again makes sense because we assume that the options are also have some kind of transaction. Yes, S should be non-negative. Yeah, S should live on the space of non-negative function. Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, here it's not
the FI, are they on the average from below? Or
the functions
FI,
except the power, except the power option, they are bounded by AFI function, by linear function, and the power option is bounded by G. But and here, well, here we say that the canonical process is a positive Martingale, so it's not very important if you take the canonical space as the space of continuous function of the positive function, because we impose here that the canonical process should be positive Martingale with respect to measure. So this is the assumption that there is one Martingale measure that have this condition for the prices. Just this is an assumption. So what's a portfolio? Portfolio is a pair which consists of your static position and a trading strategy. And then the portfolio value is given by this form. So this term, the last two rows you already saw in the classical transaction cost. And the first row is the static position. And this term you can define pass by pass. So you can consider this problem also in model free or in almost surely. Problem in this portfolio defined pass by pass. Okay, so now we have two questions. So suppose we can ask two questions. So one, if the model is given. Model given, it means that on the canonical space we have a probability measure which satisfy, let's say, in the meantime, we'll say satisfy the condition of full support property, but just to say what's the model given, that we have a probability measure on the space of functions. And we want to do it, S here is the canonical process, but we don't do it for any pass. We do it P almost surely. When P is some probability measure. So that means that you have a model. Okay, so you will throw sets of measures here. So you have one superimplication price. You want to minimize the price of the static positions under the superimplication property. But the superimplication property you have almost surely. Okay, the payoff is less than the portfolio value, almost surely. And you can say the robust. You can say robust that now you want to do the same, minimize the cost, but now you want to have the inequality for every pass. Here, for every pass, positive pass, which starts with S0. And the main result says the following. The main result says, before I go to main result, I should need to do something. Okay, but the main result says that they are equal, but also we want to have some duality. Okay, so we have we have two superimplication problems. One is to minimize the cost of the static, to minimize the static cost under superimplication for any pass. And the other problem, when you have a model, so you want to do it on a set of measure one with respect to probability of the change. So we have two problems. And in a minute, we will see that they are the same, but just from the duality point of view, so it's well known that for usual transaction cost, consistent price system play a key role. Here we have some kind of modification which will work with the with the model free case, and also which will respect, of course, our option prices. So formally, here a price consistent system can be seen as a probability measure on the product of a continuous function, positive continuous function, which starts from S0. So you have here S hat is just two-dimensional. S1 is the canonical process on the first element in the product. S2 is the canonical process on the second element. And a consistent price system is the following. So S2 plays the role of the shadow price. S2, so it should be a martingale, and it plays a role of the shadow price. And this condition plays the role that we should respect the prices of these options which are given in the market. Okay? And observe that the no arbitrage assumption that we have in particular imply that this set is not empty. Okay, we have our assumption stated that even if you take kappa equal to zero, and here instead of equal or less you take less, you still have something. So this set is not empty for any kappa. Okay, it follows from our assumption. And again, I don't know what happened if you don't have this assumption, can you get arbitrage? It's okay, but so the set of consistent price system is defined in this way, and we see that there is no underlying measure. Okay, this is just, there's no underlying measure. You don't need to be equivalent to something, so just a measure on the product of two spaces of a continuous function. And now we are ready to formulate the theorem. The theorem says that if you have the conditional full support property, if the model that you took has the conditional full support property, then for a payoff which is regular enough, you get that the superapplication price, if you allow yourself to delete set of measure zero, or you not, if you want to do it for any pass, it's the same, and it equals to the supremum over all consistent price system. But of course, you plug in the payoff, you plug the first process. Okay, S1 playing the role of the stock, and S2 playing the role of the shadow price. So you plug in the payoff, you plug S1. Okay, so this is the main theorem. So in fact, this is in some sense a generalization of what we had without options. But here there is a sense in dynamic array. For instance, in this setup, we can super-applicate a look-back option. Okay, I have a few minutes in there. I will explain briefly how we can super-applicate options. So this is the main result. And so the power option play a key role if you want to super-applicate. Passwising qualities. This is a paper on passwising qualities by David Bock and four authors. And it says, I mean, we use that. Sorry? It's not alphabetically? Oh, the family. Sorry. Sorry? In fact, it's elementary in quality, but very useful in all of the papers that we did for mass stuff. So it says the following. So if you have a maximum of just numbers, yeah, maximum numbers from 0 to n, in any power, in fact, you also have x and x, but for us it's sufficient power. It's true, and this is why it's very helpful for a mass, because it just, you don't need any probability, just a number. So it's smaller than xnp plus some kind of, I don't remember by heart, but some functions of the previous one, minus xi. Okay, here, there should be some constant, and plus maybe some, yeah, some constant. Yeah, I don't know. But what's important here, that if you consider, so in fact, you can do it in a passwise sense. You can say that if you have a passwise, if you have a pass, continuous pass, it's called xt, you can say that this is smaller than some constant xt in the power of p, which is the power option, plus some integral, which is the Stieltjes integral. Okay. And gamma in fact is monotone, I think, decreasing. So this, of course, you can super applicate a look back option, but if you don't have transactions. But in fact, it's specific gamma that in this paper, the transaction costs are the transaction cost that you pay for such strategy are of order, I mean, not exact, but of order this maximum, or even bounded, multiplied by something small, something like 8 kappa. Okay, so if kappa is small enough, and that's our assumption, because we use this probably additional assumption we have, probably the theorem should be true without this assumption. But if kappa is smaller than 1 dividing by 8, by putting plugging everything to the other side, you can see that you can, if you have a power option available, you can super applicate with transaction cost the lookback option, even a power of the lookback option. Okay, so that's why a power option is very essential assumption in all what we did on robust stuff, because this kind of equality we use very frequently. So this is just a remark why we need a power option. Yeah, so this is just a technical explanation. How you use the passwise inequality and some kind of randomization of times, but it's not just technical. What I want to say is that this kind of inequality is very essential to the stuff that we do, to how we start with it. So just simple idea how we prove our approach to the theorem. And in fact, our approach was based really on previous papers that I said from 2008. Their idea was help us is to get one side of inequality. So the idea was that if you have a conditional full support process and you allow, if you allow shadow prices, in fact you can construct in the limit a process with, I mean, any multiple. Maybe I'll just say what I mean. So for instance, even if you have you have a simple random walk, but normalized, okay? So you have so clearly this process, if you insist that it will be a multivariate, this process can converge to only to Brownian motion. In some sense what I'm writing now is the Bachelier version of what we need, but just maybe in a simple situation. But suppose you allow yourself to take shadow price. So suppose you have epsilon bigger than zero, and you allow yourself to take any processes, let's call them xt hat, such that they are far from xt by epsilon. Okay, you can take supremum over z. Okay, almost sure. And you insist that x hat will be a multiple. Then you can, by choosing right the correlation between the C, you can take this process, let's put an index on n, such that it will converge, for instance, to almost everything you want. If you take epsilon, you can converge to, for instance, to two Brownian motion or three Brownian motion, yeah, by allowing this epsilon, the shadow epsilon. You can take this process, such that it will be non-trivial, but it can converge to two Brownian, and that's the reason that you get, in some sense, concave envelope. So the same you can do geometrically with the Brownian motion. So for Black-Scholes model, you start with, let's say you have a co-option, and you have a fixed volatility, but you, by taking shadow prices, you can converge the processes to with volatility as big as you want. So for instance, if you have this curve, we know that the price, let's say the Black-Scholes price, when you take the volatility to infinity, it's exactly as zero. So this is the reason why you get the buy and hold, because if you allow this kind of window, you can create measures which will be close to Black-Scholes, but not with the volatility you started, with any volatility that you the main idea. And we used here, so formally it means that formally, we show that if you have a robust superapplication, so the first inequality is clear. Of course, if you have superapplication with the model, it's less or equal than superapplication if you don't have the model, okay? Because you allow yourself to throw measures, sets of measures zero. What is not trivial is the second inequality, and that's what I say. It's based. It's one part is really based on this kind of techniques. Says the following: suppose you have a robust problem, and you compare it to non-robust when you have a model, but the transaction cost a bit bigger. Then the superapplication, the robust superapplication, is smaller equal than the non-robust when you have a model, but with a bit bigger transaction cost and with a bit bigger prices. Okay, so this kind of inequality was essential. And then the last part, which I want to go into details, is to say that you take the limit as epsilon goes to zero, you get the same result. And of course, the second inequality is true only if P have the conditional full support property. If it doesn't have the conditional full support, it won't work. With the conditional full support, we can construct this kind of method. So, that's what I want, is that if we define this kind of thing, we want to show that there is a continuity in kappa and p. This is the technical step, how you take epsilon, from previous slide to zero. It says that this function, the dual function, is continuous in the parameters. It's kind of work, but I won't go into details. I just want to say just some kind of related work on the robust edging. There is a paper by Bouchard and Nutz on consistent price system in discrete time, and also by Barakhtar and Zhang. Both of the papers, they do a discrete time, but when you don't have a fixed model, so we have, in a sense, model-free edging with transaction cost, and there's some condition when you get arbitrage. This is the second paper. If you get arbitrage in terms of consistent price systems, of course, which are not equivalent, they don't have a dominating measure. Okay, just one, last thing that I will say related to this shadow price. And this is some kind of, not really related to the top, but it's kind of problem that I just wanted to share. Shadow price, and also by a paper of Kozoka from 95, past minutes. And it's a bit related to transaction costs and all this thing. So suppose you have a random walk, 1 to NT, XI, and I didn't write it, but XI are plus minus 1. And now you allow yourself a process, but are scaled. In sense, you allow yourself to take any process such that the difference will be scaled in the sense that it's smaller than kappa square root of n. So in some sense, it's related to transaction cost when it's Bachelier version of binomial models, when the transaction costs are range. So at least for so here, and now you require that this is the shadow part, this is the mapping, and now you ask yourself what can be the limits of such measure. So there is a theorem by Kozoka, say that the limit of such measure can be any convex hull, that's a measure of the following form, measures of alpha t, and this is the Wiener space, but alpha is now, is not equal to 1, alpha can be equal, be from, it can be stochastic, so it can be from 1 minus 2 kappa, and 1 plus 2 kappa. So if you have a convex payoff, you take the highest, and if you have non-convex, if you have a concave, you take the lowest, otherwise you take the depends. So what I want to show is the point. So I was thinking, suppose this is a random walk, converge to Brownian motion, but you can do also a bit different. You can say that you take any two values, A and B, with product 1, let's say A is negative, B is positive, and A, B is 1. Then, if you take impossible, that's minus 1. And now you take CI IID, which accepting values A and B, with probability, it's not very important the probability, but just, and you consider this kind of random walk. So, of course, there is one Martingale measure, and under this Martingale measure, it will still converge to Brownian motion. Okay, so it can be considered as like other binomial models, it still will approximate the Black Scholes model. And now you consider the same problem as here. You allow yourself process xn minus is smaller than kappa square root of n. And in that case, what I saw that the limit will be, so it's not, in that case the limit will be not like this, but the limit will be like at least the upper bound will be smaller than 2 kappa A plus B. Okay, so of course A plus B, I will put absolute values. So of course this is bigger than 2. So in some sense, the maximal, if you approximate the Black-Scholes model by binomial models, it depends on the approximation, and the maximal is the upper value, the maximal that you get is when you have a symmetric angle. So for me it was a bit strange. If you consider transaction cost, it depends on the model, on what model you choose to approximate the Black Scholes. But that's just what I wanted to say. Thank you very much. Theorem. So if you have a condition of full support model, then the dual, you don't need to take probability measures which are equivalent to this. You take anything, it's like the robust superhedgehog. But for kappa bigger, of course for kappa equal to zero, it's not true. But, But for kappa bigger than zero, yeah. But we have a regularity condition. The payoff should be Lifshitz and et cetera, et cetera. So that's, for any payoff, of course.